the choreography myself. Hey honey, have you gained some weight in your rear end? The dress you wear reminds me of my old girlfriend. And where'd you get those shoes? I think they're pretty lame. Would you stop talking, 'cause I'm trying to watch the game. If you're a man who wants to live a long and happy life, these are the things you don't say to your wife. I planned a hunting trip next week on your birthday. I didn't ask you, but I knew it'd be okay. Go make some dinner while I watch this fishing show. I taped it over our old wedding video. If you're a man who done that, a long and happy life, there's all the things you don't say to your wife. Solo. Okay. Your cooking is okay, but not like mother makes. The diamond in the ring I bought you is a fake. Your eyes look puffy, dear. Are you feeling ill? Happy anniversary, I bought you a treadmill. If you're a man who wants to live a long and happy life, that too. These are the things you don't say to your wife. If you're a man who doesn't want to get killed with a knife, these are the things you don't say to your wife.
Good morning. It's good to see you here. Thanks for showing up, spending your Sunday morning with us. For those of you who are visiting with us for your first time, my name is Kim, and my husband Bill and I are the lead pastors here at The River, and we are so glad that you're here. And over the next few moments, I'm going to be sharing with you the second installment in our new series, Me and My Big Mouth. So if you've got the YouVersion app, we invite you to tap into that and follow along. If you don't have it, you can find out more about that app at the Next Steps booth immediately following service. But in the meantime, I'll have some of the scriptures and some of the notes on the screen directly behind me. So if you'll turn with me to two passages of scripture, we're going to jump right in and get started. Go to Philippians chapter 2, verse 14. Philippians 2, 14. I want you to put a marker there. We're going to get to this a little later on in the message. Then go with me to Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21. Proverbs 18, 21, we're going to get to that in just a hot second. So last week, Bill kicked off this series by telling us that every word counts, that our words have value, that our words have a creative force behind them that impact our lives. And while we are not like God in that we cannot just speak anything that we want into existence, we do have the ability to impact our world with words. He said it like this, that words create pathways for our future. That stuck with me all week. And he supported that fact, that truth, with Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21, which is our first scripture today. I'm going to be reading it to you from the Amplified Version. This scripture says, "Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it and indulge in it will eat its fruit and bear the consequences of their words." So in other words, this passage is telling us that if you use words, whether you speak them or you write them or you sign them, or you use Morse code, or however it is that you use words, those words are going to produce something. And whatever those words produce are the consequences. And Bill reminded us that consequences are not necessarily a bad thing. Consequences are just simply the result. So whether the results are good or whether the results are bad, we're going to taste, we're going to consume, we're going to ingest the consequences, the results of those words. In fact, I've been thinking about this so much that as I was reading over this and meditating on it this week, the Lord drew my attention back to verse 20. And so I want us to look at that really quickly. So just pop up one verse. And verse 20 says, "A man's stomach will be satisfied with the fruit of his mouth. He will be satisfied with the consequences of his words. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it and indulge in it will eat its fruit and bear the consequences of their words. A man's stomach will be satisfied with the fruit of his words. Now, we read this, and it feels very positive to us. It feels positive because the word fruit is in there. And fruit, for most of us, is a positive thing. We all like fruit, even if it's just one kind of fruit. And we like it because it's sweet. It's delectable. It's tasty. We enjoy it. And so a man's stomach will be satisfied with the fruit of his mouth. We look at the word satisfied, and it feels very positive to us as well. In our culture, when we think of the word satisfied, we think of being content or pleased or gratified. But you got to remember that the Old Testament was written in Hebrew. And so when we look at a word in English, it doesn't always convey to us the full and complete meaning of something that it was intended to, because we're using our 21st century Western understanding of a word. So I went to the original Hebrew text for the word satisfied to see what it means. And that word in Hebrew is savak. And it does mean to be satisfied, but it also means to be filled, to be full, to have in excess, to be sated. Now let's talk about that word sated for just a moment. It's not a word that we use too often, but I can give you one phrase and you're going to completely understand what it means. Post-Thanksgiving dinner. Right? You're sated. You have just spent 20, 25 minutes eating juicy turkey and wonderful sweet potato casserole and fantastic green bean casserole and some cranberry salad and warm, yeasty, soft rolls. And you topped it off with maybe a little pumpkin pie or pecan pie or apple pie or sweet potato pie. And then you had a nice maybe cup of warm cider or some hot coffee. And you push back from the table and you go, I cannot eat one more bite. I am stuffed. Sated. That's what sated means. And so when we look at these two scriptures, Proverbs 18, 20 and 21, it's telling us that our words are going to produce something. And whatever they produce will be the consequences, will be the results. And whatever those results are, our lives are going to have those results in excess, be full of, be stuffed with those consequences, which are either supporting and promoting life or leading to death. Wow. Words are pretty important. No wonder the Bible talks a lot about words, about what we say. Which brings us to our second passage of Scripture, which is Philippians 2:14. That verse says, do everything without complaining and arguing. As I was preparing for this past week, I came across some research from Stanford University that shows that complaining damages the brain. Specifically, complaining shrinks the hippocampus. Now, if you're not real familiar with the brain and all its integral parts, let me just kind of quickly give you a very simplistic overview of that. Your hippocampus is located in your temporal lobe, and it is immensely critical and necessary for problem solving, intelligent thought, and emotional stability. To show you just how big of a role the hippocampus plays in your life, it is the first and primary area that is significantly impacted and damaged by Alzheimer's and depression. So your hippocampus is extremely important for your overall health and well-being. And it is shrunken by complaining. This damage occurs because God designed our brains for efficiency. Have you ever heard the term muscle memory? It's the ability to reproduce a particular movement without any conscious thought. It's like going on autopilot. You do something without consciously thinking about every single step that is required to complete that entire action. So in reality, muscle memory is more about brain efficiency than it is about your muscles. And this is how it works. So we'll say this is your brain. And your brain is full of neurons. These are two neurons. And the very first time you ever do anything, this information begins to wash through your brain and your neurons are like, so what's happening? What's going on? We've never done this before. How is this supposed to happen? How is this supposed to work? Where do we go from here? What is going to be the end results? And they take that information that is flowing across them and they begin to compartmentalize and organize and file this information away. And every single time you repeat that action, your brains begin to, okay, we're familiar with this. There's a rhythm to this. We understand what's happening here. And so they start to reach out to each other to ease the flow of information. That's called neuroplasticity. And as you repeat those actions, whether you're practicing your golf swing or learning how to play the piano or sing or cross-stitching or memorizing something like your phone number, your brain begins to stretch out those neurons closer and closer together, building a permanent bridge, linking those actions together for simplicity and fluidity. And with every single repetition, that bridge is strengthened and the connection is secure. In other words, a repeated action rewires your brain so that it can more effectively and efficiently accomplish a task. So it makes it very easy for you to repeat that same behavior again in the future. I'm sure you've said the phrase, it's like riding a bicycle, right? That means that I know how to do it, and all I have to do is just get on it and do it again, and I automatically remember how to do it, even if it's been years since I have done it. It's because there's a bridge there, a secure bridge that has been built that helps you go from point A to point B just like that. You can do those things without thought or action. So repeated complaining rewires your brain. It rewires your brain to make future complaining more likely. When you complain, your brain is rewired so that in any situation you find yourself in, any problem, any conflict, you automatically find the negative first. You begin to see the glass as half empty. You look at anything and see problems and difficulties and impossibilities. It becomes very hard for you to see the positive, to see the possibilities, to see the good in any situation. And the results of continuing complaining means that complaining becomes our default behavior. And we then develop a pessimistic worldview, meaning anytime I look introspectively at myself, all I see is the negative. Anytime I look at my spouse or my children or the situations that I find myself in at work or what's happening in our world, all I can see is the negative. And as I see the negative, I then complain about what I see, which then reinforces the bridge and causes me to complain more. It sounds to me like Stanford University just supported the biblical truth that we read in Proverbs 18, 20, and 21. Which, by the way, happened to be written around 900 BC, not by a doctor or a scientist or a team of researchers, but it was written by Holy Spirit through King Solomon. He told us that we are going to be stuffed and full and have in excess the fruit of whatever comes out of our mouth. And if we complain, we're going to be stuffed with the fruit of negativity. And negativity doesn't support life, it promotes death. It contributes to death. And the science just showed that. It affects your spirit, we know that. It affects your mind, your will, and your emotions, and it affects you physically by impacting your hippocampus. I knew that Holy Spirit had led me to this and showed this to me. And as I began to think about that and turn it over in my mind and contemplate all that it meant, I felt like he also showed me something else. Because as I was meditating on that, I realized that Stanford University just gave us scientific proof of strongholds. Now, what's a stronghold? Well, by definition, it's a military term that refers to a fortress. It is an actual physical location that is dominated by a particular group of people and is very well fortified and supplied. Strongholds are centers that control a particular area or a region, determining what is going to take place in that area or region. We live in what was once known as a stronghold because we live in Fort Gratiot. It was a fort established by a particular group of people who controlled everything that took place at the mouth of the river and this territory. So as I begin to think about that, I realized that 2 Corinthians 10:4 talks exactly about this same thing. 2 Corinthians 10:4 says that even though we're humans, we don't fight wars and battles the way humans do. We're not fighting a physical battle with human strategy and tactics and human weaponry. Instead, we're fighting a spiritual battle. And the weapons that we use are God's weapons, and these weapons destroy strongholds. Strongholds of human reasoning. Where do these strongholds of human reasoning reside? Right here. Right here in our mind. The spiritual stronghold that 2 Corinthians is referring to is the well-fortified fortress in our thinking that is dominated by the enemy. And through this stronghold, the enemy is controlling that area of thinking and has tremendous influence in our life. So you might be asking the question, well, then how did I get a stronghold? Where does that come from? Well, strongholds are often established through wounds, perceived wounds, and lies. When we experience pain, when we believe something that is not true, the enemy gets a foothold and is able to secure a particular area in our thinking and build a fortress there. And he's able to do it because we partnered with him. Now, I know a lot of us are thinking, wait, I don't partner with the enemy. I don't want anything to do with the enemy. But the reality is we do. One of the greatest things that you can ever understand as a follower of Jesus Christ is the fact that you have been given free will. When God created and designed humanity, he imparted to us free will, which means that we have the ability to choose anything we want to choose. We have the ability not to choose something we don't want to choose. Even when it comes to salvation and God's work in our life, free will is always in play. So, Jesus has come, he has saved the world, and he offers salvation to any who would receive it. I choose. I choose whether or not I want to be in relationship with Father God through Jesus Christ. Once I'm in relationship, Jesus comes to me and he says, I see a particular area of your life where you're not experiencing all the freedom that you really have. Can I set you free here? I see an area of your life that is broken. Can I come in and mend it, replace it, and make it new? I see a place in your life where you're deeply wounded. Can I come in and heal it? And we get to choose whether or not we want freedom or healing or restoration. It's our choice. And as we say yes to him, then we partner with him to accomplish this work that he wants to do inside of us. And the same thing is true for the enemy. At any given opportunity, but specifically through wounds and lies, the enemy will come to us. Now notice the difference. Jesus says, here I am. I am your Savior. I'm the one who loves you. I'm the one who sticks closer to you than a friend. My name is Jesus. This is what I want to do for you. The enemy comes disguised as you. Always using personal pronouns because he never wants to reveal who he is. Because he knows if he says, so listen, I'm the devil, I'm going to lie to you, I want you to believe me. We would never fall for that, right? So he comes to us and he says, that hurt. I feel this. I don't like that they treated me this way. I'm going to that. I want to. I think I should. And we go, yeah. I am mad. I am hurt. I will tell them what I think. I will go this way. I will open this door. I will shut this door. I'll put a stop to that. And we partner with him by agreeing with him. And one of the tools that he uses to build a stronghold in our life is through the agreement of our words. So if we have trouble with negativity or pessimism, or we're always focusing on the problem instead of all of the possibilities, then we have helped the enemy establish a stronghold in our mind, in our thinking, through complaining and arguing. Every single time we complain, we're just handing the enemy another brick and saying, you might need this so we can make it a little taller. Every time we criticize, we say, oh, you might want this. This will make sure it's secure and it's level and it's balanced. Every time we gripe and fuss, oh, here's some mortar. You're going to need that to make all of this part stick together. Use that. Oh, and you're going to need this too. Fuss, gripe, argue, complain. That's going to make it all work better. Which, by the way, the name of this message is, it's just another brick in the wall. Every time we criticize, we complain, we argue, and we backbite and we fuss with each other, we are just handing him supplies to build. Here, build a new wing. It needs to be bigger. We need a second floor. We need an upgrade. Take all of this. Sounds really harsh, doesn't it? Shocking. None of us would ever intentionally hold the hand of the enemy and work in partnership, in relationship with him, and build a stronghold that he can then work from and control us from. But that is exactly what is happening when we complain and when we argue. And that's exactly why Holy Spirit is warning us of complaining and arguing in Philippians. He said, do everything without complaining and arguing. Everything. And he really did mean everything. I was hoping he only meant some things. So I started to dig in to find out if maybe there were some loopholes to this whole thing, because I think it makes sense that you should be able to complain if you're sick or if your tooth hurts or if you have to have a tooth pulled. I think you should be able to complain if your husband's a jerk or your boss is a pig or your coworkers are obnoxious or if you don't have enough money at the end of the month. Or if your kids are just ridiculous, I think you should be able to complain about that. But as I scoured through commentaries, as I dug into the original Greek, because the New Testament was written in Greek while the Old Testament was written in Hebrew, as I dug into that, this is what I found out. The original Greek word is the word pos, and it means both individually and collectively, each, every, any, all, the whole, everyone, all things, everything. I was so bummed about that. In other words, what it's telling us is all the individual pieces that make up a whole and the whole itself, no exceptions, no limitations, no restrictions, no exclusions, no admissions, no loopholes. He says, do not complain about anything. So that means when we say things like, I don't like, I wish they would. I wish they wouldn't. It makes me so mad when it sets my hair on fire. I hate it when I cannot stand. Why do they have to? They get on my nerves. That is so annoying. This is stupid. That's the dumbest thing I ever heard. Why in the world would anybody ever? This is terrible. This is awful. This is ridiculous. I wish, or anything that sounds kind of sort of like that. We say those things about our husband, our wife, our kids, our family, our friends, strangers, co-workers, about work, about our salary, about responsibilities we have, about church leadership, about leadership at work, about decisions that are made in our home, in our church, at our work, in our government, on a global level, changes that should be implemented, changes that should have never been implemented, how they organize the grocery store, how they work the rhythm of a traffic light, or anything else that we could think of. When we complain and make statements like that about things like this to anybody, I used to think that there were certain people who were off limits. Like, I thought that it didn't matter if I went home in the privacy of my own bedroom and said to my husband, blah, 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 that it didn't matter because it's in private. And I need to vent. I need to process. And Holy Spirit said, I said everything. There's no loopholes here. We're not supposed to complain about anything, criticize anyone, to anybody, because when we do, it's just another brick in the wall. And we just keep fortifying the enemy, and we wonder why we can't get free. And we wonder why we're struggling. And we wonder why, when we criticize people, decisions and ideas and situations, whether we had any involvement in them or not, whether we know the person or we don't, we've just helped the enemy build the stronghold. And we do it all the time. Now, I know some of you are probably sitting there going, I'm not a negative person. I don't lean toward the negative. And that's a good thing. But let me tell you this, you still complain. And you're not negative yet. Even if you try to be super positive everywhere you go, listen, you get home and you sit in front of the TV and you start watching TV and people start showing up on your screen and you got a lot to say. And you know it's true, that's why you're snickering. We look at people and they come on camera and we just start ripping them to pieces. They are a terrible actor. Ugh. I don't even know how they made it in Hollywood. Didn't they look in the mirror before they showed up on set? Come on. You knew 3 months ago you're going to be on TV and you didn't use whitening strips? Your teeth are horrible. All you need is 7 days. And you knew. They have got the biggest nose. They have no talent whatsoever. They are not attractive. How do they ever make it? That dress is hideous. The men think that this is mainly a woman's issue and that's what's going on in our head or what we say. What in the world do you think an armchair quarterback is? What's all this yelling at the ref or the umps about? Come on! Y'all know it's true. It's nothing more than criticizing and complaining. Complaining and criticizing and grumbling and whining and moaning are nothing more than having an opinion that is different from the one that is currently being expressed. And then you're passing judgment on that opinion in a disapproving way. You're saying my opinion is more valid than yours is. And all that complaining, all of that expression of dissatisfaction about another's opinion leads us to what? Arguing. We argue about as much as we complain. We debate, we protest, we dispute and have heated discussions about anything and everything. We will debate about trivial and insignificant topics like how to put toilet paper on the toilet paper holder. Isn't that the truth? We have heated discussions about standing or kneeling at a sporting event or whether donkeys or elephants should be running the country. We will even have intense fellowship about the meaning of Scripture. Pick a topic, pick any topic, and it can get heated just like that. Because we got opinions, and we think ours is right. In fact, my opinions might almost really be facts. Isn't that what we feel? And the fruit of complaining and criticizing and arguing is dissatisfaction. The results are frustration. The consequences are constant disappointment and depression and discouragement and resentment and general overall unhappiness, discontentment. Our lives are stuffed and have an excess of negative emotions that just keep us bogged down, feeling overwhelmed, and producing despair and hopelessness inside of us. And to top it all off, all that complaining and arguing is just helping the enemy build this fortress in our mind so that he can continue to control that area, keeping us in a pessimistic state of mind, preventing us from connecting to the promises of God, stopping us from seeing God's goodness, putting blinders on us so that we don't see God's faithfulness, keeping our focus turned and our attention tuned in to everything that is wrong instead of seeing everything that is right. And it's just casual conversation to us. We talk about the weather. Oh, I hate winters. I hate the snow. I hate I have to get up early and, like, warm my car up, shovel the driveway, get all that frost and stuff off my car. I hate that. I got to wear all these extra clothes. Man, I can't stand it when my husband leaves the toilet seat up. It's just so annoying to me. I hate it when my kids don't put their clothes in the laundry basket. Me too. I can't stand that stuff. You know what I hate? I hate blah, 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 blah. And we feel like we're just having friendly banter and chit-chat with our girlfriends or our guy friends as we're hanging out at work or over dinner or whatever. It's just casual conversation to us. But for the enemy, it's strategic warfare. He is taking advantage of our lack of knowledge. He is exploiting our ignorance. The Old Testament tells us that God says his people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. Because we don't know how deadly complaining is, we do it all the time. About everything to anyone who would listen. Now, I'm not saying that you can't express opinions. What I am saying is, what's your purpose for expressing your opinion? What's your motive in expressing that opinion? Are you talking about the problem because you're a part of the solution and you're working toward change? Are you just throwing your 2 cents in to say what you're going to say? So how do we fix this? This is a big problem. How do we fix this? Can it be fixed? Because remember what I said earlier, it's like riding a bike. It's like riding a bike because there's this permanent pathway from point A to point B to ensure that we never forget something so that we can just pick up right where we left off and keep going forward. Can this be undone? And the good news is, yes, it can. A stronghold can be torn down just like it went up. One brick at a time. That thing can be pulled down using the weapons that God gave us. And how do we do this? We start by checking our heart. Jesus said in Luke chapter 6, verse 45, that what you say flows out of what's inside your heart. You don't say anything that wasn't deep down inside of you to start with. It's inside of you because you've thought about it. You've meditated on it. You've given credence to it. You ever gone through been in a conversation and you go, oh, that just slipped out. that little French word I just said slipped out. No, it didn't. It's in your heart. That's why it came out. Everything you say flows out of what's inside of you. And so when our hearts are full of jealousy or envy or resentment, dissatisfaction, bitterness, unforgiveness, and offense, your language just easily converts to complaining and criticism and arguing. So we've got to inspect our heart. We've got to check to see what's down inside of there. Then next, those thoughts that we find deep inside of our hearts, we got to take them captive. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5 says, we are destroying sophisticated arguments and every exalted and proud thing that sets itself up against the true knowledge of God, and we're taking every thought and purpose captive to the obedience of Jesus Christ. Now, Bill did this illustration a couple of years ago with Bill Forbes, and it was really powerful, and I used it again this summer when I was teaching women's Bible study here on Wednesday nights. And I thought it really applies and it fits because it helps us understand exactly what we are supposed to be doing mentally. It puts this good picture in your head. We cannot allow ourselves to go on autopilot anymore, because if we do, we're going to keep getting what we've always had, which is negativity. So if we're going to stop this thing and disassemble the stronghold, we're going to have to get off autopilot and pay attention to every single thought that we have. Rewiring our brain so that it supports life requires us to look at every thought that shows up and says, I'm not going to stab you. Get over here. And we say, what was that you just said? Say it again. You don't sound like Jesus. You don't look like Jesus. You don't smell like Jesus. Doesn't have that fragrance of Christ. Stop. I told you I wasn't going to use you because you just create a ruckus. Stop. And so I smell him and I say, you don't smell like Christ. You don't smell like the fragrance, the aroma of Christ. How do you make me feel? You make me feel uncomfortable. You make me feel unsettled. You're producing worry and angst inside of me. You don't compare with any truth that I know. You don't fit a mold anywhere. So I'm going to give you to Jesus just to see, because Jesus is going to be the litmus test. And we say, you go to the feet of Jesus. And Jesus, I give you permission to do anything you want to do with that right there. Because if it's not from you, I don't want it. So you can go. That's what you're supposed to do with a sword. But you got to be intentional about that. And every single time we are intentional to inspect the thought and discover where did it come from and what is its purpose here and what are your plans to do here, and I discover you don't belong, then I'm going to get rid of you. I'm taking another brick out of the stronghold. I'm taking it apart bit by bit. So the first thing we've done is we've checked our heart. Number two, we're inspecting what we find there to see if it matches up with Jesus. And number three, we've got to renew our mind. Romans 12:2 says, don't copy the behavior and the customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. As we dismantle the enemy's stronghold, we got to establish a new fortress. One that is built in partnership with Holy Spirit, and the foundation of it is truth, and its walls are truth. So we've got to partner with him to change what's going on in our heart, so that what's going on here influences how we think, and then what we think is influencing what we say. So we're on the front end. We're going to have to be very intentional about filling our minds with truth. That's what your sword is. Your sword is the sword of truth, and it is the only thing that can disassemble anything that was created by the enemy. The sword is the only thing that pushes back the enemy. That's what we talked about earlier in 2 Corinthians 10. That the weapons we use are not carnal, earthly, human weapons. We're using spiritual weapons, and that's the sword. You sharpen your sword by soaking in the word. You got to soak your heart in the word. David tells us in Psalms that we've got to hide God's word in our heart so that we don't sin against him. We often think that scripture memorization is for what they do in children's church and Sunday school. That's a lie from the enemy. Scripture memorization is what every follower of Jesus Christ should be doing, hiding that word in your heart so that when the enemy comes to you and he's making suggestions to you, hoping that you will partner with him to put another brick in the wall, you'll pull out that sword and you'll go, that doesn't match this. I will not agree with you. I do not partner with you. I choose to say truth. Act on truth, speak truth, live truth, carry the truth out. And when I talk about saying it, I really do mean say it. Because here's the deal. If we just think we're going to shut our mouth and not complain, we've not changed anything. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Oh, I'm not going to say nothing. I'm not involved, so hey. Well, you just said it without saying it. Everybody knows you don't like it. They just don't know the details. There's no difference in that. When someone comes up to you and they want to criticize another person, you don't just keep your mouth shut. You say, hey, wait a second. What does God think about that person? Let me look for the good and what's happening in that person and in their lives and the decision that they're making right now. I don't like what they did at work. Okay, well, I'm not in charge. And I trust that the people who are in charge know what they're doing. They've got way more information about this than I do. And so I'm going to follow them. When the enemy is making suggestions to us that we ought to criticize people, that we ought to slander them and gossip about them, we have to have God's word hidden in our hearts so that we know how to deal with that. We have to be very purposeful and intentional to own the front end, load ourselves with thankfulness and gratitude and appreciation and gratefulness and respect and honor and love. How do you stop gossiping about people? How do you stop criticizing everything they do? You honor them. You respect them. And you love them. We change the way we see people because we have front-loaded truth about people into our hearts. And so when I'm tempted to criticize or I find myself in a situation where people are criticizing, I have that and I say, I can't say that about them because I love them. If what you're saying about someone cannot be said to their face, or you wouldn't say it to their mama or their kids, you don't need to say it. It shouldn't be a thing. And if you're thinking it, there's a problem in your heart. And that has got to be pulled out and expected and compared with truth. And truth determines whether or not it stays or whether it goes. And then we swap it for God's truth. What does God say about that person? Even if I don't know them, even if it's just the random checker down at the Walmart, even if it's somebody on TV and it's the persona that they are portraying to me, it doesn't matter. God loves them. God loves them every bit as much as He loves you in all their foolishness, just like He loves you in all your foolishness. And that's what I have to be obligated to and committed to and decide. This is what I'm being intentional about. So I'm not going to speak about things and people and situations to anybody that is not the heart of God on this situation. And if we will commit to this, we're going to find that our life is stuffed. It has an excess of joy and peace and contentment and happiness and pleasure. If we'll live this way, we'll be able to push back from the table and say, God, I can't take one more bite of your goodness. I am overwhelmed by how great you are and your love and how good things are for me because you bless me everywhere I go, in my coming and in my going, in my lying down and in my rising, in the city and in the country. No matter where I am, you're there and you're blessing me. I'm so full of that hope begins to overflow in me. And I see opportunities instead of obstacles, and promises instead of the problem, and provision instead of lack. It makes a difference what we say. It makes a difference in us, and it impacts the people that are watching us. Your words count, and they have value. And they're creating pathways into your future. I want you to bow your heads with me. And the first thing I want to ask you, is there anyone in here who would say, I am not in a relationship with Father God through Jesus Christ, and I want to have a relationship with God. I want to give my heart to Him. If that's you, would you raise your hand? That's great. Everybody in here knows Jesus. Bring somebody who doesn't next week. The next thing I want to ask you is, who has been convicted about the words of your mouth and complaining and criticizing and arguing? That's awesome. I want you to stand with me. Because the reality is, we really do complain. The problem is, very seldom do we actually investigate our language to discover how much complaining we do. So I want to invite you to let Holy Spirit just have free reign inside of your heart and your mind and expose everything that lines up with the enemy. Everything that the enemy is using with your permission to build a stronghold in your mind. And I think if you'll do this, God's going to rock your world. I think He's going to reveal some things to you that you never knew were there. So bow your heads with me. And together we say, Father, we open our hearts to you. Holy Spirit, we give you permission to expose everything in my life that is a result of complaining and criticizing and arguing. I give you permission to convict me when I start to go down the old path of complaining and criticizing. Grab my attention so that I can see clearly what I'm doing. And give me the strength to change direction. Forgive me for being a person of complaint. Forgive me for being argumentative. But Father, I just ask you in Jesus' name for every single person who stood here and was courageous enough to admit that they've partnered with the enemy and they've built some things in their lives that don't belong. I ask that you would release your power inside of them. I ask you, Father, that you would take them at their word. If they've invited you to convict them, I ask you to convict them. Even if they've been so busy during the day that they didn't catch it, when they lie down at night, you would replay that conversation over through their mind. And that, Holy Spirit, you would train their hands for war, teaching them how to use the sword of truth. Teaching them how to brick by brick disassemble the stronghold of negativity in their life. And show them how to partner with you to construct a fortress of truth that controls and dominates every single part of their thinking. And we praise you, Father, because you desire this more than we do. And your strength will be more than enough to accomplish the task. We ask you to rewire our brains so that immediately we see you in every single situation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Be seated with me for a second. So I want to invite you to do something with me. About a month or so ago, with my rooted group, I had a complaining challenge. And the challenge was we would go 7 days without complaining. All 24 hours in the 7 days, like we didn't get a break. So from 7 days, we would not complain. And I felt like I'm going to do this. I'm going to do this so good because the Holy Spirit had been dealing with me about this for a long time. I've been on this journey for a while, and I felt like I was a pretty positive person. Yeah, so, anyway, I discovered there was a lot of parts in my heart where it had just become comfortable and normal, and I didn't even realize what I was doing. And so, I was sharing this with Bill, and what we decided is that we would invite all of you to do the complaining challenge with us. And so, starting on November 12th, we're going to go 7 days without complaining. That gives you 2 more weeks to listen to sermons. Get it all out. Just get it out. That gives you 2 more sermons about you and your big mouth before you jump into this, because it's going to be a thing. It's going to be bigger than you think it is. So if you want to participate, we're going to have daily devotionals on the Rivers app. We've got a church app. If you need information about how to download that, you can go to Next Steps. They'll tell you how. And starting on the 12th, every single day we will have different devotions that talk about complaining and changing the words of your mouth. We'll also have some things through the church's Facebook page. So if you're not on Facebook, then you can follow it through the app. But if you are on Facebook and you haven't liked the church's page yet, you need to go do that so that you can connect with what we're doing. And we'll also do some Facebook Lives to encourage you in regards to staying the course and being more centered on truth and speaking truth and living truth and walking the truth out. And hopefully this will be a jump start for you to a lifetime without complaining. And it will also be the week before Thanksgiving, and it'll get you ready to spend time with your in-laws. So, we'll talk about that more when we get to it, but just keep that in mind and get prepared for it.